What's up, rookies? Welcome to another snippet on what pharmacists do, where we showcase what pharmacists do and explore inspiring pharmacy career paths. In honor of Pride Month and in celebration of diversity, equity, and inclusion within the pharmacy profession, we welcome a very special guest today, Dr. Jim Scott. Dr. Scott is the Dean of Touro University, California College of Pharmacy, my alma mater, and also a past president of the California Society of Health System Pharmacists. Dr. Scott, thank you so much for joining us.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
Awesome. So let's start by talking about your career. How did you decide to pick pharmacy as a profession?
I kind of stumbled into it. I was in undergrad and I was flat broke and I needed a job. And a friend of mine was working in a hospital pharmacy as a technician. And this is back in Florida where you didn't need a tech license or anything at the time.
Okay.
And he wasn't getting along with one of the pharmacists. He wanted to change sites, but he needed to find a replacement. He
Okay.
knew I needed a job.
Okay.
And so he hooked me up and I walked in. January 9th, 1989, to a hospital
Ooh.
pharmacy, not knowing anything.
Okay.
And for the first few months, I thought, no, they're real busy and they don't get out of the basement. And I don't know if that's what I want for my future. And then one of the interns graduated.
Okay.
And I was talking to her about all of the interesting things that you can do in the profession and some of the things that she was planning to do, which she is still doing now 30
Okay.
years later,
Okay.
34 years later.
Okay.
And I said, maybe. And then I started thinking back in my first year in pharmacy school where I was working for the Career Resource Center and I was able to see how like salaries of different majors, and pharmacist was always the very last one, greater, equal or greater than some number. Every single one who ever submitted one of those reports was always
Yeah.
in that. So, okay, so you can make some decent money. And so then I just started that process.
All right. So just like me, I was a pharmacy technician too when I first started. And then one of the reasons I like to share what pharmacists do is because as a community pharmacy technician, I always just thought that pharmacists were set to play that role. But through speaking to other pharmacists, and like you spoke to the intern, you realize how much more you can do, how much potential the pharmacy profession has, and the money is not bad. So you decide to go into pharmacy school. So now let's kind of talk about your career from there, your path from there. You are now the dean of Touro University, California College of Pharmacy, which is, in my opinion, one of the highest achievements in a pharmacy academic career. So how did you prepare for this role? Tell us about your path from which pharmacy school you went to now being a dean and everything in between.
Sure. So I was in Gainesville at the time and I was working I was at the University of Florida and I was working for the community hospital. And so I didn't even think about any pharmacy school other than the University of Florida. This was back when the PCAT was required, and I did really, really well. So I didn't even realize that pharmacy school was competitive because my PCATs were high, my GPA was high, and I just didn't even think about it. So I did my 4 years, and as I went through them, I realized a couple of things. Number one, I was going to have to do postgraduate work if I wanted to do some of the things that I was interested in doing, such as research and having kind of a larger scale impact on patient care.
Okay.
And I realized that I was interested in working with people with HIV.
Okay. Okay.
I didn't have any very close friends who were positive, but back in the early 90s, it was ravaging the LGBT community, primarily
Yeah.
gay men.
Yeah.
And
Yeah.
I knew that they needed help. And so when I was getting ready to graduate, I was looking for a fellowship in infectious diseases. And I had several interviews and they went well, but I wasn't getting any offers. And one of them finally said, "You know, Jim, your application materials look great. The problem is that everybody you're competing against already has a residency and you don't." And so here I am, April of 1984 or 1994, needing to do a residency. And I lucked out that the VA across from school, one of their matches couldn't fulfill the commitment because of a visa issue. It was a VA. And so I interviewed the day before commencement. I got the offer the Monday after commencement. And so I did a geriatrics residency at the Gainesville VA Medical Center. And then I went back and applied for fellowships again, and I got one at the University of Illinois at Chicago. Chicago is actually my hometown. My mother had moved back there, so I had a lot of reasons for wanting to go there. And it was a very highly regarded program. I wanted a fellowship that let me do research as well as patient care. And it did. I was able to do direct patient care research, direct patient care lab research, and do publications and stuff like that. So it was really kind of broad spectrum. Leaving there, I found a position in Buffalo with the clinical pharmacokinetics lab. That doesn't exist anymore. And people of my generation in pharmacy know of that, but not many people in your generation do because it was very well known at the time of like area under the inhibitory
Was that
curve,
like
the eight.
Dr. Winter's generation?
I think it was during his time and then a little bit after, but like the AUIC came out of the clinical pharmacokinetics lab in Buffalo. A hospital merger happened. My position kind of got lost as things shifted departments, and I needed to find a new job. And so I landed in Los Angeles in 2000 at Western U. And so I expected to stay there for 5 years. I stayed there for 21 years. They were specifically looking for somebody in HIV. I wanted to get back into it. I was able to. So for the first 10 years, I did HIV work. I did patient care. I had students on rotation. I was developing a really solid research program. I had started my own residency program. And in 2007, I went through an academic leadership training program through the American Association of Colleges of Pharmacy. And so following that, I started looking for some advancement. And fortunately, my dean at the time was able to find a position for me there. And so in 2010, I took over the role of Associate Dean for Experiential Education at Western U. And so that's a senior leadership position within the college. And it really helped me to take ownership of a department, of a budget, to be able to come up with projects and then make them happen and then assess how they worked and then go back and change things as needed. So doing a full 360 on projects that I had generated or that the team had generated, the leadership team. And
Got it.
so and experiential is what, 40 to 45% of a curriculum. And so I had a really good perspective of how to do all of that stuff. And so then when I started looking for a dean position, I looked at a number of different places and some were better than others. Some seemed like they might be good fits, but they didn't agree. And some I didn't think would be good fits and they disagreed. But it just happened that in 2021, I had interviewed at Touro and it worked out. It was felt to be a good position for both parties. And so I started in September 21.
Wow, what a fascinating journey. It doesn't sound like you always wanted to be a dean, though. So you started off wanting to be in research and infectious disease, and you did the residency and the fellowship, and then you had the job with the clinical, with the pharmacokinetics lab. And then Western University. So because of the merger or the closure of the your past job, you lost the job and then now you found yourself in academics. So you didn't always have the I want to be a dean kind of mindset from the beginning.
I didn't know what I wanted to do. I knew some of the things I didn't want to do. I didn't know what I did want to do yet. And it was 2007, maybe 2008. I was coming out of a faculty meeting, talking to a colleague, and I actually ended up taking his role a couple of years later after he left. But he said, "You know you're going to be a dean someday." And I laughed at him. And he's like, "No, really, we've been talking about it. we know you're going to be
Wow.
a dean someday.
Wow.
And that planted the seed. And so that actually might have been 2006, because I did the leadership program after that. That's that was part of that process of developing the leadership skills so that I could eventually go into a dean position.
Gotcha. So someone saw something in you and planted the seed. And I think we all need people like that in our lives to kind of
We
steer
do.
us in.
And not just to see it, but to tell them about it.
Yes,
Yeah.
absolutely. Mentors and sponsors, we need you guys. So
Sure.
and so your journey to becoming a dean really is fascinating, inspiring. As we explore your career today, though, I'm also interested in understanding more about your personal journey. Can you tell us about the pivotal moment when you first realized that you were gay?
Well, I won't go into too many details, but I remember it as if it just happened yesterday. And it was puberty, as happens with many people within the LGBT community. I was 13, and I was staring at the particular person, and my mind was wandering. And as I started focusing my thoughts, I was like, "Holy crap!" And I was like, "I don't do it. Am I what?" And I thought about it overnight, and then the next day I was like, okay, I guess that's what it is. And I didn't completely say, well, that's the way it's always going to be, and there's never any other option. So I dated a couple of girls in high school,
To be sure.
and I knew that I didn't feel that connection that I should be feeling with them. And so when I went to college, I left town. So I was living in St. Pete, Florida when I graduated high school. Gainesville, Florida is about two, well, it was 2.5 hours at the time because of the speed limits, but it was just a couple hour drive away, but far enough that I knew I wouldn't have family kind of watching every
In your
move
business.
and stuff like that. So I was able to start looking for friends, and I ended up developing over those 8 years, eight years, a really close set of friends, a large group, about 25 of us. And we still keep in touch.
So you were 13. So when you decided that you wanted to be a pharmacist, is this something that you publicly came out with as you entered your pharmacy career, or at what point in your pharmacy journey did you decide to just be yourself and let everyone know who you are and be authentic about yourself?
Yeah, so I guess some more context. So when I was 13, this was early 80s in Michigan, so a red state. And I went from Michigan to Florida in about 83, so another red state in the 80s. And so it was not being out was not something that I was comfortable with because of the people around me. And so that kind of shaped a little bit about everything else about me, that I can do things. I have skills. I can have a presence if I want to. And being gay has nothing at all to do with that. And so I could still do everything that I wanted to do. So when it came to my professional life, I had some stuff in my CV when I was leaving school, being president of the LGBT group on campus. And somebody actually, one of my faculty advisors said, "Are you sure you want to have that in there?"
So you
And
left it in your CV.
I did. And I said, "I don't want to go to a place that it's going to be a problem. Even if they don't have a problem with me, but they have a problem in general, I don't want to be there." And so it was subtle and it was in there. The people when I start, so I was friends with another gay man in my fellowship. So we had actually met in a chat room, a pharmacy chat room or LGBT, I forget exactly what it was. We had met, we became friends, and he was more out because he had gone to the school in Chicago. So he kind of outed me. And then the people who did my references from my fellowship outed me to my first position. But I never really talked about it because it's not relevant at work. When I came to Western U, There was another faculty member who had started 2 weeks before me who was gay and who was very out. And we picked up on each other really quickly. And he outed me to to people there, not too broadly, but enough. But it was still that I didn't, I never hit it, but I didn't wave a banner with me all the
Got
time.
you.
And over time, as faculty members came and go, some knew and some didn't, and it didn't really matter. Most of the students didn't know because I never talked about it because it's not my personal life is not their business.
I agree.
But some knew, and maybe it's because I was the only one who ever gave the LGBT health lecture in class. But when I became a dean, I started looking at things differently, and I said, yes, it's my personal life, but I need to now be more of a role model. I need to be a definite, intentional role model. I'll still be act the same way that I do, but I'm not going to hide the fact that I have a husband, and I'm not going to be afraid to be seen with him on campus or something like that. He'll when he's up in the North Bay Area, he'll be with me on once or twice a month or something like that for whatever reason we're going somewhere after work. But I just felt that the pharmacy is a relatively conservative profession,
It
and the LGBT people, male, female, non-binary, whatever they consider themselves, need a positive role model. And so that's what I have intentionally been doing since I got to Touro.
So you never really just decided to come out. People, it was subtle in your CV. People picked up on it and out at you, like you said, but with a lot of support, it seems like. And now you're intentionally being a role model for your student because you're in a position where students come to you for mentorship and direction in several aspects of their lives. So, but were there any specific challenges you encountered in your pharmacy journey specific to your sexuality?
So I had some issues in school. So by this point in pharmacy school, and this by this point it was early 90s. In again a red state, and I it's a long story, so let me see if I can crunch it down a little bit. But I did some stuff that ended up outing me to the class in the summer between the P1 and P2 year, and we could talk about that scenario because it's an interesting story, but we can do that offline if you want. But when the beginning of the second year started up, I felt that discrimination. Where you come in 2 minutes before the lecture starts and you find the first open seat, and there's there you could see somebody had been sitting there and they went to the bathroom, something like that. And so I sat down in my seat, and then this person came in, saw me, took their belongings and sat somewhere else, not even like next to a friend, just different. And half the class wouldn't talk to me at all. Nobody called me names. Nobody physically abused me or threatened me, but it's those microaggressions that you just feel. And until you felt them, I don't think you really know what the microaggressions are. And so I felt them when I was in school because of that whole scenario.
Were there and I imagine at that time there weren't really any support system or mentors within the pharmacy community to address that with.
Well, I think that if it had gotten to the point of affecting my mental health more or my grades or something like that, I would have reached out. There was a faculty member who I knew who I didn't know if she was lesbian or bi, but I knew she was part of the community. I ended up working for her for a couple of years as well. I worked full time during pharmacy school. I don't recommend anybody to do it, but I did it. And so I knew that if I really had an issue, I would be able to go to her for at least direction on how to handle it. But it wasn't just stuck to the students, the faculty knew as well. And I had one faculty member who bought a t-shirt that we had designed that supported the LGBT group on campus. And he I just had them sitting because we had just done finished them, and he's like, I'd love to buy one. How much are they? And actually, one of those t-shirts Tom Petty wore on an interview on MTV that
No
we did.
way.
Yeah,
And
because
you
he lived in
designed a
Gainesville.
t-shirt.
Yeah.
Impressive. So there were some challenges, but you were just focused on your work. You did well. It didn't affect you mentally or anything. But you feel like if you had reached out, there were people available that could support you and guide you in that way.
Exactly.
Okay. So now, do you think, I think you probably already answered it in a way, but do you think that your sexuality affects your leadership style at all?
No, because I'm actually pretty good at compartmentalizing. And it's not like my personality style is alcoholic or abusing drugs or to be significant. Oh God, what's the term? Passive
Impact.
aggressive or those types of things. I'm just a person. And so I've never ever seen a reason why it would affect me. Like I said, I had it in CVs. I have not talked about it at any interview. I've not said, is this going to be a problem? Because I don't care if it's a problem for them, as long as it doesn't, if they didn't like me
They wouldn't
because
give
of
you
that,
the
they didn't
job.
hire me because I wasn't hiding it. It was in my CV.
So no. So you just lead at Dr. Dean Scott and with all the passion and the knowledge and the mentorship you want to impact on the students. Awesome. Can you share, have you in your several leadership roles, been involved in any initiatives or programs that would support the LGBTQ plus individuals in the pharmacy profession?
I indirectly because of my work with HIV. And so I've been involved not just in direct patient care, but in working, well, my 10 years practicing was at the LA LGBT Center. So there was a big part of that. But in the US, if you are working to help people with HIV or to end HIV, you are helping the LGBT community because it's part of the community. There's no way to ignore that fact. And so some of the work I've done in that area would be a part of that. So, for example, SB 159, which was signed a couple of years ago, is the HIV PEP and
Pep
PrEP.
and prep,
So me and a couple of colleagues helped CSHP put together the training program, and it was the first training program in the state to prepare people for it. And we actually worked with the Board of Pharmacy to figure out what that training needed to be. And I was fortunate. I drafted a proposal for what that training should be. It was reviewed and discussed at the Board of Pharmacy meeting. The
Amazing.
next meeting, I had revised it based on those comments that
Amazing.
had come out, and it was approved. And so those requirements, I wrote those. And
Amazing.
so that to me has probably been the biggest impact that I've been able to have
Hello,
is
yes.
to make sure that pharmacists are prepared, but
Yes.
to not make it onerous enough that they're afraid to do it.
Yes.
Of course, SB 159 rollout has some other issues related to it and out and stuff like that. But the stuff that I've impacted, I've been very proud of that.
That is amazing. Cannot be. I mean, the program is being used to this day. I mean, like you said, it may have had some a little bit of touch up from the grassroots movement from when it started, but just being part of that is it's an amazing thing. So it's like what they say these days, hashtag goals. When I hear your story, I'm sure many pharmacists, including myself, would like to someday just be at least half as successful and impactful as you have been to pharmacy as a profession.
And I'm twice as impactful than I ever thought I would be.
Amazing. Amazing. So just keep the faith, right? I mean, we're gonna go over this in the advice section later because we want to know how to do it, how to do this, how to be this successful. So here we go. Advice. Considering your journey and leadership and experiences, what advice would you offer LGBTQ plus students and any minority students or any student who is just starting their career in the pharmacy profession? What advice would you give them?
I it's hard to verbalize. My like I said, my philosophy has always been, my identity is my personal life, and I can have a professional identity, and there is overlap, but I was not hired because I was gay. I was hired because of my experiences. My general recommendation for people wanting to go somewhere is you have to have a direction that you're going in. So you have to figure that out. And it may not be your end point, but it has to be an end point. You have to have a direction that you're going in, because otherwise you're not going to go anywhere. Because it's really easy when you start making the money and you get that, that's three series BMW Pharmacist starter car, and you get that condo or the small house, and you get the 1.5 kids working on 2.3 and the dog and the cat, to forget about all of that other
To get
stuff.
comfortable.
Right. But if you want to do that, you can still figure out how to do that. You have to have a direction and a goal. And so, I knew that I wanted to teach. I knew that's really where I wanted to be. And so, my first position out of fellowship was not a teaching position. It was a hospital clinical position. But I was able to do some teaching at a local physician assistant program. I was able to teach in their pharmacology course for the first year. And for the next 2 years, I ran that course. So I started out with that. And then once I was in a full-time faculty position, my first brass ring was promotion and tenure to make sure that I could keep on going, and I could always wave that I've got tenure flag around. And then once I had decided, okay, I'm going to be a dean, but how do I get those experiences? Then I started working on that. And
Got
so
you.
whether I was Black or gay or Latino or whatever it was, the process is still the same. And maybe your steps are going to be a little bit different, but probably not. But you need to kind of figure out where it is from you. I came from a very low-income background. Grew up on single mother, three kids. I was the youngest on welfare. We received the Thanksgiving basket that was collected at the school 1 year. And so I had some challenges because of that. I had some trouble getting through college because of the money. And that's why I ended up working full time in pharmacy school. But then, you don't get guidance on financial planning. You don't get guidance on which fork do you start with when you're at a fancy dinner, those types of things. And so you have to find out, you have to pick those up. And so that's why everybody's steps in these processes are going to
It's
be
different.
different. And that doesn't matter. That's fine. You just have to have a direction that you're going in and then move there.
Have a direction that you're going in and move towards it. So just kind of have a plan. Have a plan for your life and things will unfold from there. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for sharing all the incredible advice. We're coming to a close, so just shifting gears a bit. I would love to hear about any current or future projects or goals in the field of pharmacy that you're working on. What's after Dean?
I think that's a really good question. I am fortunate enough to have a retirement account and a husband who is a number of years younger than me, and working as he is a pharmacist in the medical communications field. And so I am considering whether I want to take an early retirement or early partial retirement, maybe do some consulting. some other, maybe some part-time patient care responsibilities, but just maybe start going backwards in my career ladder and start enjoying things a little bit.
Sounds like a, doesn't sound like too bad of a plan. Doesn't sound like too bad of a plan. Is there anything else you would like to add for our listeners? Because I'm out of questions.
Right. So I wouldn't add anything about myself, but I would like to thank you for the opportunity to be here today. Your podcasts, I know, reach a lot of people and have a much larger impact than I think you can ever truly realize.
Thank
And
you.
so I
Thank you.
appreciate what you do and your intentionality with bringing in a diverse group of people professionally and personally to share their stories because
Thank you.
they will connect with people.
Thank you. Thank you. And that's my intention too. I love stories. I love sharing stories because they inspire me, and I hope they inspire aspiring pharmacy students, current pharmacy students, new pharmacists, anyone in pharmacy to continue to pursue their goal and to never give up, no matter what circumstance they find themselves in. Whatever circumstance they find themselves in. So I appreciate that you appreciate it. And I appreciate you being here today and sharing your amazing, fascinating story with us.
My
Thank
pleasure.
you to everyone who tuned in to listen. If you have any questions for Dr. Scott, you can send them my way and I'll send them to him. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel and get notified every time we come up with another inspiring pharmacy story. On to the next one. Stay blessed. Bye-bye. Thanks, Dr. Scott.
Thank you, Brigitte.